friends, so welcome to the Tuesday evening academic session from the Department of Critical Care Medicine and other specialty. Today we have Neurology Department with us to bring you to the new topic, interesting topic and debates and probably thought-provoking concepts in the medical science from Yasoda Group of Hospitals. And today to address these issues, we have Dr. Gautam B. Reddy, who is a senior consultant in the Department of Critical Care Medicine, Yasoda Hospital, Secunderabad. He will brush through a case, a story of a young boy who actually recently admitted with us and spent almost 20 days with us. And to give expert opinion, we have Dr. Vikas Agrawal, who is a senior and a seasoned neurophysician and been actively involved and discussing with us and with other clinicians regarding this case in his stay. So to start with, we will take Dr. Gautam's case presentation, which will actually brush us through the case. And then I request all the participants to interact and raise their queries so that we can take those questions with our expert panelist, Dr. Vikas Agrawal. Over to you, Dr. Gautam.
Thank you, sir. So we had this we had this patient in the mid of October.
So should I ask him, sir?
Thinking about the routine presentations in medical ICUs regarding any neurological emergency.
Doctor, please share your screen.
So good evening, everyone. So we had this patient who was very young, a student, normally always studying and always active and healthy, a young and healthy patient who was 16 year old. And he had a fever for 5 days ago before he came to our hospital. Fever was mild to moderate degree, about maximum of 100 degree Fahrenheit. Then he had rashes followed by that over mainly the upper part of the chest. Then he had altered behavior and irrelevant talk for 1 day prior to coming to our hospital. So with that history of fever, there was no headache, vomiting, or any other contributory symptoms along with that. So he sought a medical help at a local clinic for fever with rashes. As it was a peak season of dengue, so the local doctor advised him for a basic hemogram. So it showed a platelet count of about 1.4 lakh. And he ran a basic initial dengue test, which was negative. And he was prescribed antibiotics, doxycycline, and he was told to review after 5 days. So the reason for coming to tertiary center was on day six, and because his parents were really concerned with their son's behavioral change. So the initial examination in the ER and workup showed that he had a GCS of 10. He was opening his eyes to shout, shouting his name. Very incomprehensible sounds and moving limbs to pain. And there he was very restless, but there was no neck rigidity on admission. There was on and off fever in the ER and in the initial hours of ICU. So the initial infective workup, what we do, the blood cultures were sent. The tropical workup was sent again because there was a high suspicion of dengue or any other tropical fever being positive. And we did an initial CT brain, which turned out to be normal. Patient was very irritable and restless. And we thought CT brain is initial modality, so at least giving us a working diagnosis. So we went and did a CT brain. Later in the ICU, we did a CSF analysis, which showed a pleocytosis, that is increased cellular count in the fluid without any, with only lymphocyte predominant, and there was protein elevation of 81. So the differential diagnosis based on these initial symptoms and initial workup, we had viral encephalitis in mind and probably a tropical induced aseptic meningitis and dengue fever. Another tropical workup was negative, which was pending. The reports were pending. So the initial treatment, we started with empiric antiviral, keeping viral encephalitis in mind, empiric antiviral, prophylactic antibiotic, dexamethasone, and supportive measures regarding his nutrition, oxygenation, and basic hemodynamic monitoring. So on day three, he had seizures, or so we thought it is seizures. Initially, I'll come back to that in the next slides. He had seizures, and we presumed it to be seizures, started anti-epileptic drug. We secured his airway because there was ongoing activity in spite of giving a loading dose of levetiracetam. And because we secured his airway and we didn't do a MRI brain earlier, so we went ahead and did an MRI brain, which turned out to be normal in this kind of situation. And we did an EEG also, which was showing diffuse slowing. Later on the same day after we got an MRI, we had patient having this kind of activity. Sorry for the video not being aligned properly. I think he's having a kind of myoclonic jerks here. It is not a classic presentation of seizures on a ventilator or any even non-ventilated patients. We were lucky that his airway was protected by that time. He was a young and healthy boy. So now the diagnosis was why is he having a young and healthy patient with viral encephalitis in mind, with fever, rashes, and typical history? Why is he having myoclonic jerks or seizures? Why? And is it absent seizures? He didn't have any past history of any childhood seizures or febrile seizures or anything. And myoclonic jerks, usually in the ICU, we come across hypoxic conditions like post-cardiac arrest or any chronic hypoxic situation. So even that was not there for this patient. So can it be an autoimmune etiology? MRI was normal. Can it be a diagnosis of to be considered? We were thinking in those terms. Then to make the matters even more complicated, it became a jigsaw puzzle. We don't know what to fit up. And because in all the infective workup, even the CSF panel, and in tropical workup, dengue, malaria, leptospirosis, scrub antibodies all came out to be negative. Even the CSF panel and cultures were also negative. Even the blood and urine cultures turned out to be negative. So from day five onwards, we were already in the day five of treatment. Patient on a ventilator, young boy on a ventilator. He was not improving. He was continuously having myoclonic jerks. Because of this jerks, there was fever. Unrelenting fever of 104 degree and tachycardia up to 140. And he was fortunately hemodynamically maintained without any supports. And so we reconstructed blood and urine. We did the EEG again. Again, surprisingly, there was no epileptic form activity. Only diffuse slowing was there. So sedation on the ventilator, we were only giving opioid infusion. We escalated the sedation to added a midazolam or a benzodiazepine infusion also. So on day seven, the jerks remained refractory. Dyskinetic movements were seen in the orofacial area. This was especially seen when the patient was being weaned off the ventilator. Otherwise, jerks, even on high dose sedation, he was having continuous jerks. So PET CT was advised, and I'll show the films in the next slide. There was an increased activity in the basal ganglia and decreased the perfusion in the parieto-occipital region. And the CSF and the serum was sent for autoimmune encephalitis panel. Because of this extremely violent jerks, we were worried about the rhabdomyolysis and sent us initial CPK-11. That turned out to be negative later. And based on the PET CT finding, we started pulsing this patient with 1 gram of steroid for 3 days, and followed by IVIG for 5 days, for 30 grams per day first 3 days, followed by 25 grams per day for the next 2 days. And in spite of being on a high dose opioid and a benzodiazepine infusion, propofol infusion was also started. So continued movement disorder and dyskinetia even on day 8, and sensorium remained the same, even E1, M4, VT, that was upon stopping the sedation. Otherwise, he remained E1, M1, VT. And another characteristic finding, what we came across this time on day 8 EEG, when we repeated, this is the third EEG we repeated. Initially, there was no epileptic form activity, only diffuse slowing. And this EEG showed a delta brush pattern. I will show it in the next slide. And we ordered anti-NMDR antibody titers also, both for the serum and the CSF, and the ANA profile was sent. And we continued the IVIG. And after a pulsing dose of steroid, we started him on dexamethasone, maintenance dose of steroid. So this is the initial PET CT finding, where you can see the basal ganglia hyperactivity and decreased uptake in the parieto-occipital region. And this is the EEG what we came across, the delta brush. After the delta wave, there is characteristic brush-like spikes-like activity seen in all the leads. This is usually seen in a MRI negative patients who are highly suspected of autoimmune encephalitis. We'll discuss that in detail later. So on day 10, the Jex got controlled with after post pulsing and continued 5 days of 5BIG, Jex got controlled. Dyskinetic movements and agitation were persistent. All the routine investigations were normal. Fever also was fairly decent and he was hemodynamically maintained. So sedation, because we had already given more than almost 48 hours of propofol, we changed over to ketamine infusion. And especially in patients with NMDR positive autoimmune encephalitis, this has a counteractive because it is anti-NMD antagonist ketamine. So it has a positive effect. So we started ketamine infusion and we were unable to wean him off tracheostomy. Whenever we were trying to wean him off, he was having continuous jerks. So antipsychotics like quetiapine was added. We converted to oral benzodiazepine, kept him on ketamine and started on Dexmed because we did a tracheostomy. We wanted to wean him out of the ventilator. So from day 15 onwards, he started following commands. Agitation decreased, but the movement disorders persisted. And at this time, we got that autoimmune workup was totally negative. And the serum and the CSF panel both were negative for autoimmune workup. So antibodies were de-escalated, antipsychotics continued, and ketamine was also stopped. So weaned off ventilator on day 6. So antibiotics and antipsychotics and supportive measures continued. And from day 20 onwards, for the parents' joy, he started recognizing parents, opening eyes, following commands, intermittent dyskinetic movements were there, and he was having psychotic behavior on and off, requiring escalation of modification of antipsychotic doses. So on day 22, we shifted him to the ward, and tracheostomy decannulated successfully on 24. The discharge EEG turned out to be normal, and he was discharged after almost 1 month of stay in the ICU. So what was the final diagnosis in this case? What we made was seronegative, though autoimmune encephalitis panel, when we thought, how can the panel be negative? But there is a fair amount of chances and a lot of case reports saying that there can be seronegative autoimmune encephalitis also. So points in favor of this diagnosis, there were dyskinetic and psychotic, dyskinetic movements and psychotic behavior. And extreme delta brush pattern was seen on EEGs, which is very characteristic of anti-NMDR autoimmune encephalitis. And PET CT finding was also suggestive in favor, where there was only basal ganglia uptake and decreased perfusion in the parieto-occipital region. And because the panel was negative, it has to be labeled as seronegative autoimmune encephalitis. So the lessons learned in this particular patient, not all encephalitis is infective. That is the usual school of thought. When we have a viral encephalitis, young and healthy patient in age, usually in the younger age group, we usually think it is a viral induced infective etiology. And just because a specific investigation of choice is negative, don't discard that particular diagnosis, because we had this autoimmune panel was negative and we could have reconsidered a diagnosis, but still we were kind of convinced that it is autoimmune encephalitis because of it is movement disorder also. And do not underestimate your intuition, and a high index of clinical suspicion is required to suspect these kind of conditions. And individualize, don't go by any specific individual criteria. That criteria guidelines should be there in mind, but always individualize your application. So what is encephalitis? Encephalitis is any inflammatory condition of the brain with many etiologies. Most frequently recognized causes are the infectious one. So there can be immune-mediated encephalitis also, where autoantibodies are produced in the body, either because of a tumor and there is a molecular mimicry between the tumor and the brain cells. That is called the paraneoplastic encephalitis syndrome. And these kind of patients will have a cancer background. They'll be having either a lung cancer or a teratoma or a testicular tumor in males. And autoimmune encephalitis pattern can happen even without cancer. So these kind of conditions are a group of non-infectious immune-mediated inflammatory disorders of the brain, often involving the cortical or deep gray matter with or without involvement of the white matter, meninges of the brain spinal cord. That means there is a component of encephalitis per se that has to be there without, and meningitis is not always present. And autoimmune encephalitis is as common as viral encephalitis. So it is almost like 0.8 and 1 per 100,000 person years. And it will not be surprising as we will in the coming years, we will see one-on-one basis how every alternate patient can be turned out to be autoimmune encephalitis. This is because of the genetic predisposition and other things which the researchers are postulating presently. So the presentation of wide clinical spectrum of autoimmune encephalitis can be from altered behavior to psychotic behavior or seizures, and time course usually over these days to weeks, and viral like symptoms can be there, may or may not be there, and risk factors like malignancy, usually a small cell lung cancer or ovarian teratoma in females or a testicular tumor in the males, or autoimmune disease in 25% of the individuals can be there. But these risk factors do not mandate that if it is not there, when it is not there, you can still have a diagnosis of autoimmune encephalitis. So based on the classification of the disease is based on anatomy, anatomical locations, serological classification, and the etiological classification. Based on the anatomical classification, there are 8 or 9 different things. Limbic and cortical is the most common forms what we see. And serological classification, there can be antibodies against the intracellular antigens. Usually there will be cancer associated with that, and there will be molecular mimicry. And there can be antibody surface antigens found on the brain cells. And in these kind, we usually come across the NMDR and the AMPAR types, which are commonly seen. And antibodies to surface antigens with low clinical prevalence also can be seen, like VGKC and VGCC. And seronegative based on the if the panel is negative. And etiological can be idiopathic, paraneoplastic, like I said, with the cancer, or post-infectious complication, or iatrogenic. Iatrogenic when then cancer chemotherapy after giving immune checkpoint inhibitors or immune-mediated excessive immune modulation also can lead to this kind of autoantibody formation. So antibodies can be present against, as I said, intracellular antigens. These patients will have antibodies which are pathogenic, which are not pathogenic. That is, it is T-cell mediated. Patients have cancer and respond less to immunotherapy, and they are always linked to malignancy. And functional recovery is poor, except anti-Mato encephalitis. So patients with intracellular antigens, they have poor recovery and they don't respond well to immunotherapy. And patients who have antibodies against the surface antigens on the brain, these patients have autoantibodies which are pathologic. They respond well to immunotherapy and they are not linked to malignancy. And they have a transient neuronal dysfunction and they recover better. Based on the anatomic classification, this is the limbic autoimmune encephalitis, what we see. The cortical and limbic and cortical is what we come across usually. And most of the times, it is not mandatory that we have a brain, MRI brain with findings. MRI will be almost 60 to 70% normal in these kind of situations. So the differential diagnosis one has to consider in these kind of situations, when you have an infective diagnosis gone wrong and you don't know what is going on. These kind of limbic encephalitis can also have an infective kind of presentation, and infective workup as suited should be done. And cortical and subcortical can present with acute demyelinating encephalomyelitis. They remember here, there will be encephalomyelitis, not only encephalitis. So accordingly, the antibody workup should be done, and infective workup was also to be ruled out. And other forms of the autoimmune encephalitis, which usually will have a toxic metabolic along with the infective workup, depending on the presentation. So what is the diagnostic criteria? There are three criteria. All three of them have to be met. There has to be subacute onset. It has to be within 3 months of presentation. And there should be a short-term memory loss, altered mental status, or a psychiatric symptoms. And at least one of the following, like a local neurofocal CNS findings, seizures not explained by a previously known seizure disorder, and CSF pleocytosis, that is extremely increased cellular count with lymphocytic predominance, and MRI features suggestive of encephalitis. At least one of the following. Our patient did not have MRI finding. We had only focal CNS findings and CSF pleocytosis, and all the three other factors were there in the, and the, all the other reasonable causes for infective encephalitis, toxic and metabolic things, has to be ruled out. So what is the criteria for seronegative autoimmune encephalitis? This also is like rapid progression, less than 3 months, subacute presentation only with altered mental status or a psychiatric symptom. And other well-defined syndromes like typical limbic encephalitis, Bickerstaff's, and ADEM, acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, has to be ruled out. and absence of well characteristic autoantibodies in both CSF serum and should be there with at least two of the following criteria: MRI abnormality suggestive of autoimmune or CSF pleocytosis or a brain biopsy, which is usually done in the rare conditions. And what is the diagnostic algorithm? Coming to the diagnostic algorithm, so when we have a patient who is suspected to have autoimmune encephalitis, there has to be a confirmed focal or multifocal brain pathology. So we can do a brain MRI without a contrast and followed by EEG. If MRI is negative, or patient is encephalopathic or having frequent seizures. If a brain MRI is also not suggestive, then we can go for a brain PET also if MRI is negative. Then we have to confirm the inflammatory etiology and rule out competing possibilities like doing a basic lumbar puncture, including the and CSF analysis for autoantibodies and blood test for the serum autoimmune encephalitis panel. And if brain biopsy is diagnosed, is really not clear in rare situations. And then we have to screen for associated neoplasm in the young patients and usually do the initial organ scan followed by a whole body PET CT if nothing is turns out to be positive. So what are the CSF and the serum considerations in these kind of patients? We have to run a basic blood test that we have done already in this patient. We have done a basic cell count, differential TC, DC, protein, glucose, and then do the autoimmune test. Not very specific to this kind of situation, but still saying that autoimmune activity is going on within the CSF. So for that, we have to do a CSF oligoclonal plants, a CSF albumin and IgG level, and a CSF autoimmune panel has to be sent. And broad viral studies like HSV PCR and varicella PCR has to be ruled out. And bacterial fungal studies have to be done as appropriate. And cytology and flow meter, flow cytometry to rule out any malignancy. And why we have to do serum albumin, that is for the IgG index, I'll come in the next slide. Serum albumin and IgG level, serum for oligoclonal plants and serum autoimmune panel also has to be sent. So next, after the CSF, what is the initial finding is a pleocytosis, that is with lymphocyte predominance, protein will be mildly elevated. Oligoclonal plants can be present, which can be sometimes present in absent in the serum. That doesn't mean that CSF is present and serum negative doesn't go against the diagnosis. There can be still autoimmune encephalitis. These are nothing but clumping of autoantibodies present in the serum that is seen as oligoclonal bands. It is not very specific. It can be seen in multiple sclerosis patients. It is very classical there, but still this can be considered as a supportive criteria for your diagnosis. And there can be an elevated IgG index as a percentage, usually expressed as a percentage of CSF to total protein or albumin. Index is usually less than 0.6 to point less than 0.9 based on the lab cutoff value. And this is the basic autoimmune encephalitis panel what we run in most of the lab, most of the standard labs. The most common detected autoantibodies with the first five, that is the acetylcholine receptor and binding antibody, NMDA, VJKC, and LGA1. So these four and another GABA, these are the five autoantibodies usually that we come across in most of the labs. But most of the autoantibodies, we don't know how many autoantibodies are being produced. Newer and newer autoantibodies have been detected, and we don't have a target to detect these kind of autoantibodies present, even if they are present in the system. So what is the limitation? Normal CSF studies don't exclude autoimmune encephalitis. So a CSF autoimmune encephalitis panel has to be considered even if the routine tests are normal. And serum testing can yield false positive antibody results. So if an isolated antibody is found in the serum and this doesn't fit with your clinical picture, consider repeat testing. So don't go with only serum testing alone. You have to have a CSF panel also matched together. As more and more antibodies are discovered, there may be an increased rate of false positive antibody tests. And some patients with autoimmune encephalitis may have negative serological tests because their antibody target hasn't been discovered yet. This lack of an identified antibody doesn't exclude the diagnosis. And MRI, usually it excludes CBA or metastasis or any infective findings like leptomeningeal enhancement. And a signal hyperintensity can be there on the flare or T2-weighted images, and it is sensitive up to 70%. And can remain normal even with contrast enhancement. EEG may show focal or multifocal abnormalities when MRI is negative. Abnormal EEG findings may support a diagnosis of encephalitis. Focal slowing or seizures, especially when localized to the temporal lobes, it can be there. It is not like you have to see epileptic form activity always. And periodic lateralized epileptic form discharges or plates can be seen. Extreme delta burst, this is a very characteristic finding, and more case reports are there where this is a study which has been done in 2016. Extreme delta burst pattern is so common in these kind of patients, almost 30% reported in this particular RCT. 30% of the patients had extreme delta burst pattern on MRI, on the EEG with autoimmune encephalitis diagnosis, and all of their MRI who had extreme delta burst were MRI negative. MRI was absolutely normal. So these kind of patients, when MRI is negative and we have a EEG of delta burst, then you have to consider a diagnosis of autoimmune encephalitis. These are the post delta wave. There are spikes like toothbrush pattern, what we see in EEG in all the leads. So coming to the management strategies, one is the immunotherapy, that is the standard, that is the treatment of choice, followed by control of symptomatic therapies, like treatment of seizures. If there is a raised ICP, usually is not the condition in the situation in these kind of situations. Movement disorders are a major thing to handle, and then followed by autonomic dysfunction. So immunotherapy, when it comes to immunotherapy, there is no high quality evidence regarding the optimal therapy. There is no fixed dose regimen here. Like in other immunomodulating conditions, what we see, we pulse the steroid with, pulse the patient with steroid with 1 gram methylprednisolone for 3 or 2 to 7 days, followed by immune exchange, plasma exchange, or IVIG, cyclophosphamide or rituximab, whichever is safer in the appropriate according to the condition. And if patients with having a paraneoplastic symptom, we have to do a tumor resection and start a proper chemotherapy. So if the patient is, your all diagnosis draws down to one point, if the patient is having cancer or not. If the patient is having cancer, you have to follow the treatment according to the cancer as it is mandated. We have to have a testing diagnosis for a biopsy followed by chemotherapy and tumor resection. That is a standard care. If patient does not have a tumor, then you have to see whether it is mild to moderate. Mild to moderate is in patient is mild to moderate autoimmune encephalitis, as in he does not have severe movement disorders. Patient is in kind of conscious, GCS is okay, obeying to commands. These kind of patients, we have to load the patient with IV methylprednisolone pulse dose of patients, and followed by either IVIG or PLEX according to the situation, clinical situation, if there are no contraindications. But in severely ill patients, like in ICU patients who are on ventilator, refractory movement disorders, you have to do a combination therapy of a pulse dose steroid, followed by either IVIG or a PLEX as this conditions is appropriate. If usually we go for less invasive techniques these days, because PLEX has its own merits and demerits, even considering IVIG, but we choose a less invasive, the first modality will be usually the IVIG, if there is no contraindication. If there is no improvement to IVIG or PLEX, then we go for rituximab. And if there is still no improvement, then we go for cyclophosphamide, followed by immunomodulators in the recent still under trials. Cyclophosphamide usually we avoid in younger generation of patients. And coming to the other symptomatic management of seizures, we have to, as always, with the seizure management, first we have the basics, coming to the airway breathing and circulation, followed by a benzodiazepine after 5 minutes. Usually we give a lorazepam. If there is no IV access, you can give 10 mg midazolam IM. And another antiepileptic after 5 minutes if seizures are still not controlled. And do a basic metabolic, rule out the basic metabolic abnormalities like hypoglycemia and hyponatremia. If seizure stops, okay, that's fine. Otherwise, you have to, it's almost like 15-20 minutes seizure, still patient is still seizing, then you have to intubate the patient and start propofol infusion for cerebral protection. Autonomic dysfunction, usually we'll have high grade fever. Even in our patient, we had a high grade fever of 104, 105 degrees with all the cooling devices used, but we didn't have any infective workup with autoimmune negative. So these kind of patients will have fever, and infection is not always the diagnosis. So it should be aggressively managed with external cooling devices or IV cooling IV saline. and cold saline. And then significant hypoventilation can require intubation, and avoid aggressive treatment of hypertension or tachycardia. They can go to the other end of the spectrum. And bradycardia may sometimes require a transvenous pacing, and be prepared for permanent pacing in rare cases. And sympatholytics to curb this autoimmune dysfunction, like alpha-adrenergic agonists like clonidine and propranolol can be used. And monitor for ileus or toxic megacolon. Coming to the movement disorders, they can be usually of two types in these patients, that are hyperkinetic disorders and the myoclonic stress. Hyperkinetic can be a dystonia, dyskinesia, or hyporia. Cholinergic neurotransmission seems to be the pathology behind all this, and initial anticholinergic agent can be rapidly effective. So dopamine antagonists or recent VMAT2 inhibitors like valbenazine has also been equally effective. And myoclonus results from usually cortical irritability, and treatments may include either anti-epileptic drug or usually anti-epileptic drug. So if a patient is having any of the situation conditions like coma, status epilepticus, respiratory depression, agitation, or refractory movement disorder, then go for Dexmed infusion, IV benzodiazepine, propofol infusion, or opioid, or a neuromuscular junction or a paralytic agent if in rare circumstances. Then if a patient is not having all of these symptoms, then it depends, the diagnosis depends on either patient is having hypokinetic or hyperkinetic dyskinetria. So hypokinetic, we go for levodopa. Hyperkinetic movements, we go for anticholinergic drugs, beta blocker, and antiepileptic. If there is dyskinetic movement, usually this will be the presentation, dyskinetic movements not responding to initial treatment, the treatment of choice will be the anticholinergic drugs, dopamine receptor blocker like valbenazine, dopamine depleter, and alpha-adrenergic blocker, and benzodiazepines. So to summarize, what is the prevalence of autoimmune encephalitis? It is almost like 1.2 per 1 lakh population, about 5 to 8 cases, but it is an increasing trend as per the researchers and based on initial clinical trials, and it can affect all the patients of all the age groups, including infants and the elderly. And it is, what is the disease as such? It is caused by when the immune system makes antibodies that are not supposed to be there. These antibodies attack either healthy brain cells, wrongly identified them as invaders, and causing inflammation of the brain. And how do we diagnose? Blood test, lumbar puncture, if required, brain scan, a brain MRI, and EEG as recommended. And what causes this disease? Two potential triggers are tumors or viral encephalitis. In 40 to 50% of the cases, we don't know what is happening. The cause cannot be established. And no apparent immunological triggers is leading some researchers to postulate a genetic predisposition, and further research is on the way. And what will be the symptoms? Seizures often appear first with children. Psychiatric symptoms appear first in teens and adults. All brain functions can be compromised. Emotions, psychosis, memory loss, cognition, problem solving, speech, movement, seizures, balance, visual abnormalities, sensory sensations, and hunger, thirst behavior. All the higher cortical functions can be affected, followed by suppressed levels of consciousness, and coma even might occur. The recovery, the speed of recovery depends on degree of residual deficit, frequency of relapse according to the type of autoimmune encephalitis, and is highly treatable. This kind of patient is highly treatable group of diseases, and many of the symptoms can be reversed. Patients often have persistent cognitive and neuropsychiatric problems that persist for years, if not forever. And finally, we have our patient walking after he had a turbulent course on the ventilator. He was, during discharge, he was almost walking, and he cannot see the joy on parents' face. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gautam, for that eloquent and very elaborative presentation. And we thank our patient Partha for giving us those visuals with his permission. And as there were many queries in the question box and chat box, yeah, initially we actually considered this patient like any other patient, who a young boy came with a fever, with some thrombocytopenia, with some rash, was as a tropical fever. A dengue comes in our mind. Many tropical other fevers like rickettsial disease came into our mind. Then predominantly when it was a neuro issues and neuro-related altered mentation, so viral meningitis came to our mind. I strongly believe that many of our cases where we do only very limited viral screening, like HSV or some viral panels with a limited viruses, we just return them as a probably a negative panel, but still we level them as a, some viral meningoencephalitis, which we couldn't detect, and treat them with acyclovir for a week or so, and then we level them as that. But this case opened many discussions among our clinicians in our department also. So we thought of bringing this case. So to start with, sir, why do you thought in this case, Dr. Vikas, sir, why do you thought this may be a possibility of a viral meningitis? What are the clinical pearls in your case, which gave you an idea there may be a possibility of viral meningitis?
Actually, like any case, the history is very, very important. So the patient presented to us with fever followed by very, very irritable behavior. So there was some behavioral change. So that definitely indicates some viral encephalitis or autoimmune. So definitely we thought of viral as the first possibility. But once MRI was negative and CSF infective workup was totally negative, all the reports, viral panel, all PCRs, even tubercular, everything was negative. So we had to think about other possibilities, rare possibilities. So we thought of autoimmune encephalitis. And the patient was gradually worsening. In spite of routine treatment, all the antiviral, antibiotics, and we have given Dexona also, in spite of that, patient was worsening. Clinically, he was showing a lot of abnormal movements, dystonia, dyskinesia, even myoclonic jerks, which were continuous, not responding to multiple sedatives. So that was the clue. There is something which we were missing at that time. So we thought of doing PET CT, and again, PET CT was very, very helpful in this case. It showed us the way ahead. It showed hyperperfusion in the basal ganglia, which can cause all the movement disorders which this patient had. And then EG also helped us. So EG showed typical extreme delta brush. This is very, very classical for any autoimmune encephalitis, especially NMDA related encephalitis. However, we had negative antibodies, but still I think PET CT and EEG both were very, very helpful in this case.
So to summarize your point, sir, initially to start with the classic clinical feature, the family brought the boy to the hospital because of altered behavior.
Yes, sir.
They said the patient has a fever and thrombocytopenia, but they were not worried. They thought it can be just a viral pyrexia, where a primary clinician at his local level was treating. But the altered behavior with which the patient came to us was the first clue from your side, you felt, number one. Number two, you said there was an absolutely normal MRI. That yes. also created a doubt in our mind. Most of the times, viral meningoencephalitis may give a clue in an MRI, whether you say a temporal lobe lesions in a HSV or in any way. So absolutely normal MRI with contrast or without contrast has given a second clue. The third, initially we thought there was a seizure activity for which we have to tube this guy. But later on, when we saw those movements, we all had a discussion whether these are all involuntary jerky movement problem rather than a seizure. The reason for that is probably the seizures which we thought were happening were not correlating with the EEG spikes. So there is a discordance between the patient movements and a EEG monitoring or EEG pickup. So this again gave us a clue that probably this is not a seizure-like activity, but more like an involuntary movement. So a altered behavior and normal MRI, a movement disorder with orofacial dyskinetic dystonic movements, which further added to that. And that probably added your suspicion if we actually put across the summary. So in this context, how do you evaluate? Suppose in clinically, these are the cases which we consider viral meningoencephalitis, we empirically treat. I know many of us must have been treated a few hundred cases of viral encephalitis, not even knowing ki many of them may be autoimmune encephalitis. So how do you approach these cases from here onwards? How do you investigate them and confirm?
Sir, if MRI is negative, actually, in this case, we had a repeat MRI also, and that also came negative. So it increased the suspicion of non-infective pathology. Then we'll have to go for a PET CT for the brain. So sometimes PET CT will indicate us, will tell us that it's not infective. It may be something non-infective. It may be autoimmune. Exactly same thing happened in this patient. So he had some typical findings, which usually we are seeing in autoimmune encephalitis. So our clinical doubt, our suspicion became, we were more confident after the PET CT scan. So we went ahead with the EEG, and luckily EEG was also positive. So in that case, we started solimaxol and IVIG, and definitely patient benefited a lot with these medicines.
So, sir, in our PET, you said there are two components. One, there was a basal ganglia uptake. Contrary to that, there was also decreased uptake in both parietal and occipital zone. So, do you think this kind of PET give a clue of autoimmune encephalitis?
Definitely, definitely. It's a typical picture of autoimmune encephalitis.
Okay. And then you said, added to that, on that day, there was a delta brush in your AEG. Can you just elaborate on what is this delta brush? See, many of us in the intensive care want to know about this delta brush.
Usually in EEG, we'll have four types of waves: alpha, beta, theta, and delta. Alpha, usually we see in the normal patients, predominantly in the posterior aspect of the brain, parieto-occipital region. Beta wave is also normal, which we see in the frontal area of the brain, anteriorly. Theta and delta, these waves are considered as slow waves. So usually we see during sleep or in diffuse cerebral dysfunction or in encephalopathy. So here in the EEG, what we are seeing delta wave. Delta wave frequency is less than 4 hertz, means less than four waves per second. So here we can see typical delta waves. And that delta wave will have superimposed beta activity. That is typical of autoimmune encephalitis. Delta wave itself is not typical of autoimmune encephalitis. It may happen in many other things like deep sleep. We can found delta wave. We can found delta wave in metabolic encephalopathies. But here we are seeing brush, delta brush. That is significant. And this is again very, very typical of NMDA or autoimmune encephalitis.
Yeah, I still remember, sir, when we had this easy finding and it was reported as a delta brush, your confidence was almost growing towards confirming that this looks like more of an autoimmune encephalitis. And adding to that, the PET report turned up on the same day. So at this point of time, you asked us to repeat a CSF analysis and asked for all this autoimmune encephalitis panel. What is the role of this detecting these antibodies? Does this add to the diagnosis? Do you wait for this treatment? How do you place these autoantibodies?
Yeah. Actually, we don't wait antibody reports for the treatment, because many cases we'll find antibody negativity. Like in this case also, we had all the antibodies negative in the panel. But we need to send the antibodies, one thing to confirm the diagnosis, second to confirm the type of the encephalitis, if it comes positive, and then we can plan for the future treatment also. But even we don't have antibodies report, we'll have to start that treatment, because it's an emergency, neurological emergency. We cannot delay that treatment for antibody reports. So same thing we did in this case. We started patient with solimaxol. After 2 days, we thought that, okay, patient is not responding that well to solimaxol or high-dose steroid. Then we went ahead with the IVIG. And after IVIG, patient had significant response. Till that time, we were not having antibody report, but patient started improving. If we wait for the antibody reports, again, patient will deteriorate continuously, and then maybe we can lose the patient also, because it may take at least 1 week, 1 week to 10 days for the report.
So I take you to the practical aspect. A young boy, 19 years, from a very affluent family, educated, and were asking about the review of literatures across the globe, discussing, debating from many clinicians across the world. And at that time, we pulsed this guy with a gram of steroids for the 3-4 days. And then we spoke to them for a very expensive therapy of IVIG. And in the meantime, your autoantibodies turned negative. How do you place yourself in this position? See, we luckily, this patient improved, did well. We were lucky we could go through. But this can turn around. Some of these patients may do worse and do get. So what was the clinical push behind you to actually keep on thinking, no, I need to give this chance to this guy? What was that which is pushing you?
No, I think again, clinical examination, history, the findings on the clinical examination, the movements, what he was having, which were not relating with the EEG, PET CT, everything was indicating about autoimmunity. That's why we went ahead with the IVIG. I was thinking about rituximab also at that time. Suppose patient, if he's not responding to the IVIG or high dose steroid, then what to do? That was the bigger question actually for me at that time. Because rituximab, as we know, it's a strong immunosuppressant. So without antibody positivity, can we give rituximab in these kind of patients? I think that's a question for debate.
So how frequently the seronegative comes into play, sir? Is the seronegative being so common or?
Yeah, I think roughly maybe 40 to 50% of the patients may have seronegativity. Because we don't know, still it's an experimental area. So we don't know many antibodies which are playing role in autoimmune encephalitis.
So Dr. Gautam made a statement in his presentation saying the autoimmune encephalitis may be as common as viral encephalitis, or yes, maybe some of the data also shows that it may be more prevalent, or the incidence may be more than a viral encephalitis. So many cases which comes to our intensive care unit with a diagnosis of viral meningoencephalitis and we get all this infective panel negative. Probably this should be in our mind, on the back of the mind, to give a clue to us. So what is the current prevalence or incidence and how frequently you come across, even though Dr. Gautam presented it may be 1 to 1.5 in a lakh. What is your experience in coming across these cases?
So actually, we don't have any Indian data for that. But definitely, we are seeing few patients. We have seen few patients with autoimmune encephalitis, almost similar clinical picture. Sometimes they will present one young patient. He came to me with memory loss and seizures. That was subacute onset. It was only for 2 months. So definitely, we suspected autoimmune encephalitis in that cases. He was walking, talking perfectly all right. But he had seizures which was not responding to anti-epileptics, and he had memory loss also. Okay. So we went ahead with the MRI. We worked him up. Again, he was not having any antibody positivity, but he responded very well to solimadrol. Still, he comes to follow up. He's perfectly all right. No seizures, nothing. Memory has become normal now. So I think we should suspect more often for the autoimmune inflammation.
So there were queries which will take vaccination status of this patient. I think it was a 16 years old boy who was not vaccinated, at least for COVID. So chances of this being a post-vaccine encephalitis, I think he's pointing out ADEM, maybe more than a post-vaccine encephalitis. So ADEM is, as pointed out by Gautam, has been a differential, sir. So what is your take on this, sir?
ADEM means we'll see some demyelinating plaques in the MRI. That's a MRI diagnosis. So autoimmune encephalitis, the reports, many reports we are having, and it may happen because of infections also. So we have a term like idiopathic autoimmune encephalitis, then paraneoplastic autoimmune encephalitis, and then post-infective autoimmune encephalitis.
Exactly.
Post-infective means patients, their case reports, who are having herpes encephalitis, HSV encephalitis, they will improve with the antiviral. And then again, after a few weeks or 1-2 months, they will come back with the autoimmune encephalitis. And that is mostly NMDAR receptor antibodies.
Can this be a COVID encephalitis?
COVID encephalitis, less likely, sir. We have done RT-PCR also. We have done antibodies for the COVID. Everything was negative in this case.
So there was another interesting question. Can this be a bipolar? We said ki the psychiatric disorders, bipolar disorders comes under the differentials. A malignant catatonia can be a differential in these cases.
So one thing, it's very, very acute. Very acute. Only history of few days. He had fever followed by this. So we'll have to think about post-infectivity only. Then second thing, he had a lot of movement disorders. He was very irritable. He was in altered sensorium actually when he presented to us. And then after that, he had a lot of orofacial dyskinesias, tongue dyskinesias, then continuous myoclonic jerks in spite of multiple sedatives. So all these points favoring organic cause, some secondary cause.
Even with the history was strongly not suggestive of any bipolar or any psychiatric illness.
Yes.
Why not plasma exchange? Why IVIG in this case by Dr. Mishra?
Actually, this patient, he had autonomic dysfunction. He had bradycardia, then he had tachycardia also. He had hyperplexia once upon
Yes.
And so we thought of IVIG, which is a safer option. So
and if the flow goes the same way, steroids, IVIG, then probably plus or minus of
yes,
plasma exchange, then rituximab and cyclophosphamide. Why not it is a tubercular meningitis?
So I think nothing is favoring for tubercular meningitis because history is very short, then MRA is totally negative. Usually tubercular meningitis, we don't find normal MRA. It's uncommon finding in tubercular meningitis. Then CSF also, total workup was negative, including gene expert, we have done twice. And there's no other clue for tuberculosis in the body. So I think easily we can rule.
The gene experts, protein cells, all were probably even though he probably questioned because there were 400 cells with lymphocytic predominance, but the protein of 81 gene expert was negative. And there was no.
He had a second CSF also after 3 days. And that was normal actually. So cells became normal, then protein sugar were also normal.
Almost so that answered the second question. We did repeat the CSF. I think that was showing a recovery of the pleocytosis.
Yes,
and all.
Yes, that was normal at that time.
So there was another question that we do understand this is a diagnosis of exclusion at this point of time, but what are the clinical scenarios which will make us to suspect? I think you answered them most of those areas. Can this be a Hashimoto's encephalitis, which may present in the similar way? How do we differentiate it?
See, Hashimoto's usually again it's a subacute onset, and thyroid profile we have done. In fact, anti-TPO antibodies also we have done. Everything was okay, and then EEG was also not supportive of Hashimoto's encephalitis.
So the incidence of relapse of symptoms in these cases and treatment modalities remain the same or they change if it relapses?
Usually, the first drug which has worked in this case, I think again we'll have to repeat that drug. Anyway, we'll have to continue the immunosuppressant, oral immunosuppressant with slow tapering of the steroids for at least 2 years to prevent the relapse.
Okay, as the behavioral and the psychotic symptoms during the ICU stay, we do use some antipsychotics, what we used in this patient with quetiapine.
Yes.
So what is the possibility of extrapyramidal symptoms with these kind of situations?
See, all these symptoms started before starting quetiapine. And then again, for many days, he was not given any antipsychotic because he was on continuous IV infusions. He was giving a lot of other sedatives. So I think that's not a possibility in this case.
So there's a last question, as usual. So many of us may have access to text like CSF panel, autoimmune panels or autoimmune encephalitis panel and probably PET CT and all that. But I do understand in a resource limited setups or even our tertiary care centers, the availability of PET, the availability of these autoimmune panels may have a limitation. So as a clinician, from your angle, how do we place the autoimmune encephalitis diagnosis, and from clinical to MRI, how you actually will guide to the younger clinicians, those who need to suspect this?
See, again, first thing is clinical only. History wise, onset should be subacute, acute to subacute within 3 months. If it is chronic history, then definitely we can avoid this diagnosis. Then second, symptoms. What are the symptoms of the patient? If patient has presented to us with recent onset seizures and he's having some other associated features like memory loss, our patient is having psychosis or other psychiatric illnesses, which is very, very acute or subacute onset, then definitely we'll have to think about autoimmune encephalitis clinically. Then we can go ahead with the MRI and EEG. These investigations may also support the diagnosis, but ultimately we'll have to do the CSF and send the autoimmune encephalitis panel, and even in the serum also, and that may confirm the diagnosis.
So you said history of behavioral changes and psychosis, a subacute onset, then
yes,
a movement or a movement disorder like phenomenon which happens, and easy discordance with your seizure like activities most
yes
of the times which gives, and easy sometimes suggesting delta breast, a normal MRI, and anti or infective panel, that's mostly viral panel, which is negative.
Yeah, that should be.
And patient not responding to your conventional antiviral or antimicrobial therapy should give you a clinical suspicion. And a normal MRI again should give you a more suspicion to evaluate on that angle.
Yes.
So I think with this, with the limitation of time, I thank Dr. Vikas Agrawal, sir, for your insight and sharing your clinical experience and wisdom to all of us. I thank Dr. Gautam in bringing this case with a lot of elaboration on the acute viral meningoencephalitis or acute autoimmune encephalitis with differences and variations. And I thank all the participants in interacting with us. And I thank the Yashoda management in giving us this platform. And I conclude the session. Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.